Welcome to The Gary Null Show, a program designed to enhance mental, physical, and spiritual well-being through science and the wisdom of the ages. Let us take you on a journey of empowerment. Sit back, relax, and get ready to change your life for good.
In my experience, I do think we have the correct bug, but I think that going after the virus to the exclusion of everything else that we could control and look after is a very limited and fruitless approach. I think that's half the reason why people literally are dropping like flies when they have the AIDS virus. My experience is very different from almost every other physician. I don't have patients dying on me weekly. It's extremely rare that my clients go into the hospital, and it's very, very rare that my clients expire. So I think that we do have the right organism, but I don't think we have the whole picture by any means.
What type of therapy are you using that are keeping your patients alive and well?
Well, I think AIDS is a very complicated, multifactorial situation. I don't think we're ever going to get a handle on this disease by telling people to take some drug five times a day or bend over and take this shot. We have to look at many other aspects and start having people control and change many other facets of their life. I developed a five-point empowerment program because I think there are five avenues that need to be examined consistently, let's talk about those. The first point of the five-point empowerment program is lifestyle. People have to be willing to make changes in their life. To get their stress factor down, stop staying out all night, stop taking recreational drugs, stop drinking alcohol, and stop smoking cigarettes. Easy enough for us to say, but I know that those can be dragons that are very hard to let go of in our society. That's the first factor. The second factor is diet. People really need to clean up their diet. As you well know, we average sugar consumption is in the hundreds of pounds per year, and a high sugar diet is very clearly immunosuppressive. I think that yeast is definitely an unappreciated cofactor. Now, yeasts naturally live in all of us. We just have to achieve a balance of the yeast and us and not let the yeasts get out of control. So part of the diet changes I ask people to do is get the sugar out of their diet, get the alcohol out of their diet, get the white flour and processed foods out of their diet, get the yeasted foods out of their diet as an effort to keep their yeast under control as well. In addition, there's some evidence that the PCP organism, the Pneumocystis carinii organism, is a yeast and not a parasite. So an anti-yeast diet actually is a very self-empowering way of controlling PCP also. So point two is dietary management. Point three is using some forms of drugs when they are appropriate. I think, for instance, taking Bactrim or Dapsone when a person's T cells are under 200 to prevent PCP pneumonia is entirely appropriate. We've learned now, at least the doctors in Los Angeles are making great strides in this direction, people don't die of AIDS. They don't die from the AIDS virus, they die from opportunistic infections that get a hold of people once their immune system has been compromised, whether it's from the AIDS virus or some other unnamed cofactor. So we're keeping people alive a lot longer by giving people means of controlling and preventing the opportunistic infections that tend to come along. I use a drug I think is magical called fluconazole or Diflucan very liberally. I am very in favor of doing whatever works for my clients. When those are drugs, that's wonderful. But I am very much opposed to using ineffective drugs inappropriately, such as AZT. Another area that people need to look at is what I call nutrition of the mind. It's very necessary, I feel, to do a lot of emotional clearing, Forgiveness work, I ask my clients who are gay to come out to their family and handle these emotional issues, or those emotional issues will handle them, and develop any sense of spiritual kinship with some kind of benevolent power beyond themselves, so that they don't feel like it's just them against the world with this infection. It is my firm professional opinion that AIDS is a chronically manageable infection and will in fact prove to be a curable disease soon, I think. It's just a matter of getting the right combination of therapies and mental and emotional and attitudinal involvement together. I don't think we'll ever get control of this infection with just one drug or one pill. Another thing I have people do, and this is really the fifth point of the five-point empowerment program, is use nutrients as therapy. Now, as you well know, this has been a debate that's raged for years in the medical community, of RDA levels, or recommended dietary allowance levels, versus high doses of nutrients being used therapeutically. I use very high doses of certain nutrients which have direct antiviral and immune system boosting or immunomodulatory effects, specifically vitamin C in high doses, a la Linus Pauling, industrial strength doses, I feel is a cornerstone of an AIDS management, AIDS prevention program. I ask all my patients to take vitamin C throughout the day to what is called bowel tolerance doses. Now, the scientific name for that is the diarrhea dose of vitamin C. They take vitamin C in gradually increasing doses until they get mildly loose stools, and then they back off from their vitamin C levels until their stools are normal again. And this is about 18 to 20 grams per day. And we are not talking oranges here. That would be the equivalent of 400 oranges per day. So it's absolutely necessary and crucial to use vitamin C as a concentrated supplement. And I do intravenous nutrients also, where we just stick a needle in someone's vein and pump in a cocktail of nutrients, including high doses of vitamin C primarily. I use intravenous glutathione also, and I have all my clients take on a daily basis N-acetylcysteine, which is called NAC. NAC is an amino acid which becomes glutathione in your body. Glutathione is a remarkable substance. It deserves all the attention that our government and the NIH is giving it right now. Of course, they're trying to find a glutathione derivative, which they can make a patent for and then make a great deal of profit off of. However, glutathione and NAC work extremely well. Glutathione specifically attacks the AIDS virus from about four different steps. So we're looking at an expanded way of containing and controlling the virus with glutathione. Glycyrrhizin, which is the licorice extract, has been proven to do the same thing. It's just that glycyrrhizin needs to be used in very high doses intravenously, and it gets to be rather expensive, especially considering that the insurance companies will basically laugh at this kind of protocol and refuse to fund it. I use garlic, zinc, which is extremely important, as an immune system booster, and vitamin A, all in high doses. Actually, the vitamin A is beta-carotene, not vitamin A. Beta-carotene is a safer form, as you know. Another lesser-known fact is that quercetin, which is a bioflavonoid, does have the ability to block reverse transcriptase, which is the way AZT blocks the AIDS virus. So quercetin is a natural person's AZT substitute, and I have all my patients take quercetin on a daily basis. I think that B vitamins are very important in helping the immune system, in avoiding anemia, and especially in avoiding dementia, the mental deterioration that we see with AIDS. I think that people, even early on in the course of their infection, develop problems absorbing many different nutrients, specifically B vitamins. And I've developed a B vitamin complex as an injection, which all my patients take on a weekly basis to get around the absorption problem. In my 5 years of practice with some 600 clients, I have never seen dementia in my practice.
That's very common in most people getting traditional treatments for AIDS.
It is indeed. It is. Dementia is supposed to show up in about 30% of patients in the course of their disease, but I just don't see it at all.
Do you see any reality between all these now risk factors, and as well as the use of recreational drugs, and parasites, and what we're calling the syndrome of AIDS?
Yes, absolutely. I became aware of what we'll call a parasite problem some time ago. The holistic physicians have been much more aware that parasites do constitute yet another epidemic, along with syphilis and gonorrhea and other organisms that have proliferated in our society. I parasite test everyone who comes through the door, whether or not they have any known risk factors, whether or not they have any diarrhea or other gastrointestinal problems, even little old ladies who have no risk factors whatsoever. As you very aptly put it, all we have to do is eat raw foods or drink city water in some cases, and we are at risk for parasites. I use one lab in Arizona, which is called Dowell Laboratories. They ship their parasite test kits around the country. I have seen Dowell Labs ferret out parasites that all other labs have missed. The problem with most parasite testing is that it is notoriously inaccurate. You're literally lucky if other labs pick up parasites. So I always treat for parasites. Yeasts live in us naturally, but parasites, in contrast, have no right to be in our bodies, and they just distract our white cells, and people with the AIDS virus have precious few white cells to work with. So I always treat parasites vigorously to get rid of them, and then retest periodically every 6 months. All my patients take another purge stool test to make sure they haven't picked up new bugs.
And what percentage of your persons with AIDS or regular patient population test positive for parasites?
I'd say about 25%, even with no symptoms.
All right. And of course, one of the symptoms of parasite is fatigue.
Fatigue, diarrhea, weight loss, anemia, low iron levels. We look at this constellation of symptoms and we think, oh, the disease must be progressing due to the AIDS virus. That's not true. This is another example of cofactors which are overlooked that can be very effectively managed when we think of diagnosing and treating them.
Give us more of your understanding of cofactors.
Well, I think that there's a number of other organisms that need to be managed, primarily yeasts and parasites, as we've discussed, hepatitis, other viruses that are around,
cytomegalovirus,
and syphilis and gonorrhea.
What is your view of the human herpes 6 virus?
It's a relatively new virus. We're just now thinking about testing for it. And we are picking it up in a surprisingly large proportion of the population now that we know to test for it. So herpes 6 is another very active cofactor that can accelerate the basic disease progression.
Some have suggested there is a relationship between human herpes 6 and chronic fatigue syndrome.
Yes.
Chronic fatigue syndrome and AIDS.
Chronic fatigue syndrome has kind of been renamed CFIDS, which is chronic fatigue immune dysfunction syndrome, and has been labeled by some as, quote, AIDS minor. I think that's taking things to a bit of an extreme, but it is very clear that there are new viruses in our population. We don't know how to deal with them. We don't know how to detect them. We don't think about them a lot of the time. Another important cofactor is yet another organism called Mycoplasma. This is another bug that Luc Montagnier feels may be very significant in causing the symptoms which we mistakenly associate with the AIDS virus. I suggest specifically to my patients that they not get a flu vaccine. I think that the contents of the vaccine may be suspect, and it has been definitely shown that with HIV, the vaccine is useless at best and dangerous at worst. I think my AIDS patients are much better off not getting the flu vaccine. Also, for my population, my clients stay so pickled with vitamin C that no self-respecting flu virus is going to get near them. So my clients don't get the flu anyway.
What are your feelings again on syphilis as a cofactor?
I think it needs to be very vigorously tested. Many standard syphilis tests will show up negative in people who have also been exposed to the AIDS virus. When there are three syphilis tests that I do on all my patients, and if any one of them is positive, I think about vigorously testing for syphilis. I think this is one more cofactor that we're not adequately testing for and diagnosing in our HIV-positive population.
Dr. Priestley is one of the very few physicians who's willing to speak out against the use of AZT. Just summarize again your feelings and any additional points that you feel we should know about AZT.
Well, AZT is a toxic drug. We do know that. There is a question as to whether it promotes the development of cancer in clients who are taking it long term. This is not being discussed in the research circles or the media. It doesn't do very much. Whatever it does do, it only does it for a short period, and then ultimately the virus becomes more resistant and stronger. I think that there's a possibility that we may see a surge in this epidemic because now we are seeing AZT-resistant virus being passed around. There was a study that the VA did that was finally published. This is known colloquially as the John Hamilton study, which conclusively showed that AZT in the long run did absolutely nothing to prolong life. And indeed, people who took AZT, when they did finally become sick, they became sicker faster, and they died at an equal rate with people who never took AZT. Well, when people first take AZT, their white cells do seem to fight back as a natural reaction to AZT, and we will see the T cells, which is the kind of white cell selectively affected by the AIDS virus, we will see the T cells start to rise, but then in about 4 to 6 months, they go right back down again. One of the criteria for AZT failure is T cells 50 points lower than they were before someone took AZT, or a T cell count of 50. I think that's being very generous, actually. We do see T cells march right down to zero, and I do mean zero, while people are faithfully taking AZT. This is a drug that is clearly exerting a toxic effect and not doing anything at that point. Most of my patients come to me having taken AZT or currently taking AZT, and they recognize that it's not working for them, their symptoms are progressing, or they just feel in their heart of hearts that this is a treatment which is hurting them more than helping them. I actively discourage clients from taking AZT. I've written about 2 prescriptions for AZT. I do have certain very well-defined criteria when I think it is helpful. And when I give AZT, I ask someone to take it for 6 weeks, period, and then we reevaluate the situation. But I don't think that this knee-jerk reaction physicians seem to have of HIV, take AZT, and we'll see in 6 months when you need your first blood transfusion is very well thought out. Traditional physicians, I have to believe, have their patients' best interests at heart. They're just emotionally desperate at this point to do anything, absolutely anything, even something they know is toxic and useless, just so the physicians can feel like they're not sitting on their hands and watching people die.
A lot of physicians would say, well, we would try vitamin C or B6 or glutathione or some of these herbs if there was any proof that they worked. Fair enough. Well, there is proof. Now, the question is, if we can establish that there is proof positive from peer-reviewed scientific journals, including the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. This is the official journal of the American Society of Clinical Nutrition. It's the Bible of all medical nutrition in this country. And they devoted their most current issue to ascorbic acid, vitamin C, and its biological functions in relationship to cancer and all the good things it does. But also, there's an article in here on AIDS. When an entire issue is devoted to vitamin C and a previous issue devoted to antioxidants, including vitamin C and beta carotene. And then I asked Dr. Christopher Calliope. Dr. Calliope is a physician, a professor, an author, and a researcher who has come up with over 26,000 references in the scientific literature to the importance of nutrition affecting the immune system. Then I ask, well, if all this evidence exists, why aren't you using it? Dr. Calliope, why aren't your colleagues aware that all this exists?
Well, I think, Gary, very basically, the traditional medical approach or the way that doctors deal with patients falls far short of an understanding of what's going on with each individual. I think that most doctors don't take the time out to read or do research, and the information that they receive from either their training, their residency, or drug representatives that come into the office, that information is basically what's used to treat patients.
Now, you specialize in helping persons with AIDS and AIDS-related complex, cancer, and defective immune systems. What are some of the therapies that you have found most effective, and what proof do you have from the scientific literature that there's a rationale for using this?
Gary, there are thousands and thousands, as you know, of studies that are published every year that support nutritional evaluation, that support the use of vitamin C, of glutathione, of specific amino acids, of magnesium. You know, the list goes on and on in terms of treating chronic disorders and illness. It doesn't seem to make sense why we're not using this as the basis of treatment for all medical disorders. Something that I do very frequently with patients is something that evaluates an individual's nutritional status. It's a blood test that tells us what your vitamin and mineral levels are. The research that supports this type of testing comes from everywhere, every major university in the world. A study done at the University of Basel in Switzerland that involved over 3,000 individuals and was done over 12 years tells us that if our vitamin and mineral levels are low, then we have a significant increase in the risks for heart disease and cancer. But if our vitamin and mineral levels are appropriate, then that risk just does not exist. So even on the basis of that, yes, we can prevent cancer if our vitamin and mineral levels are appropriate. It's a very, you know, simple statement. This is only a small part of the information that exists. Whether I'm dealing with someone that has cancer or that has AIDS or that has heart disease or asthma or any of the diseases that are chronic, every single person needs to understand what their nutritional status is. We do that through physical exam and through some specific blood tests. This is information that should be done on all people, should be done on children. And then we'll be able to prevent disease very significantly in the future.
So in other words, in order to get a hold of this $700 billion a year medical bill we're faced with, and the fact that the average American is not getting healthier, is getting sicker, that we're going to have to go towards prevention.
Without a doubt.
Let's go through some of the individual nutrients to show what kind of literature exists and what they do. Specifically for people for AIDS, but again, AIDS is not a single condition, so you're helping the entire immune response across the board.
Well, I think along the same lines, Gary, in talking about the nutrients, the importance of finding out our nutrient levels, we have to understand that I think the entire syndrome or what's going on with AIDS is something that involves immune assault or damage or abuse. I don't believe that one virus can cause this problem. I believe that there's a compounding damage that occurs, and we see those individuals who are sicker or who will progress and get worse are those who have immune insult occurring over and over again, whether it's smoking, whether it's a decreased zinc level, whether it's a decreased vitamin C level, whether the person is doing some type of drug that's damaging the immune cells, whether there are concurrent infections, other viruses that are also taking up a great deal of time in the immune system. I think that's what's causing this situation, this syndrome. We could look at some fascinating studies, and again, this is the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, a study done by Dr. Harikan Jarawala that talks about vitamin C inhibiting the replication of the virus. And you know that vitamin C is a very safe substance to use. We use it both orally and intravenously in patients. It can decrease the reverse transcriptase activity so that the virus can't replicate. Other studies about vitamin C, as you well know, show that it decreases viral replication intra and extracellularly. It'll stimulate T cells, stimulate interferon, stimulate interleukin cells. It will decrease the ability for glucose and blood sugar to get into a monocyte and decrease its function, or to get into a red blood cell and decrease its function. We can also see that if we utilize a substance called glutathione, which is a naturally occurring substance that is broken down from L-cysteine, which is an amino acid, we can also stop the virus, stop the replication. This research was published in the through the National Institutes of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, and the information tells us, yes, glutathione can stop the virus. How many infectious disease doctors are using it? None.
Now, how many doctors are treating the persons with AIDS with this? Now, what if you combine L-glutathione and vitamin C, both having reverse transcriptase inhibition, this is what AZT does, but with such toxic effects. Here you have no toxic side effects, numerous positive benefits to the entire immune system. So whether you had cancer, AIDS, or anything else that's going to help you, you combine the two together and you gave it intravenous.
They work extremely well. As you know, it works in a phenomenal fashion. We also consider putting in B12 because B12 and zinc are also seen to be deficient in HIV.